Sweden just started digging a $1 billion tunnel more than 500 meters below solid bedrock. But this tunnel is unlike anything you've ever seen before. In fact, you probably don't want to be anywhere near it in the first place. The reason? Nuclear waste. This is the Forsmark spent fuel repository, a facility that's designed to store Sweden's nuclear waste for the next 100,000 years, finally solving the long-standing problem of securely and permanently disposing high-level radioactive waste. But how exactly is it going to work? And how can we guarantee its safety over such a long period of time? Okay, you're probably wondering, who is this guy and where's Regis? Well, let me quickly explain what's going on. First of all, hey everyone, my name is Luis, and I actually co-founded Megabuilds around 5 years ago. So far, I've only worked behind the scenes and launched multiple channels together with my best friend Freddy. And over the years, we built a really amazing team of scriptwriters, editors, and also voice narrators. Shortly after we started, we met Regis, who has been the voice and the face of all of our videos. And since he also works a regular job besides YouTube, you can imagine he's pretty busy right now. Narrating the channels ourselves was always in the back of our minds. However, in a foreign language, it always seemed to be a bit tricky. But now I want to take this chance to learn and also try some new stuff on Megabuilds, like showing you some behind the scenes or even going to a construction site. And yeah, Regis will let you know a little bit more about himself in future videos. But now, let's talk about nuclear energy and why the world has a huge problem that needs to be solved. The first nuclear power plants started regular operation back in the 1950s. Today, more than 70 years later, nuclear energy accounts for roughly 10% of the world's electricity, generated from more than 400 nuclear power plants all around the world. But despite the technological advancements over the past decades, there's one problem with nuclear energy that we still haven't quite figured out, at least not yet in practice. What the hell do we do with all of the nuclear waste? To understand why this is a problem in the first place, we have to distinguish the three main types of nuclear waste: low-level, intermediate-level, and high-level waste. By volume, low-level waste makes up 95% of all that's ever been produced. This includes things like contaminated clothing, tools, cleaning materials, and medical equipment. This kind of waste generally doesn't stay radioactive for long and is relatively easy to handle. They're usually stored in near-surface disposal facilities for at most a few hundred years. And yeah, a couple of hundred years is pretty much nothing in that context. Intermediate-level waste contains more radioactive material and mostly consists of used filters and reactor components. This makes up around 4% of all nuclear waste. Although more radioactive, it doesn't generate enough heat to require cooling. Intermediate level waste is either stored with the other 95% or in deeper disposal sites, depending on the duration they remain radioactive. Finally, there's high level waste, which makes up only 1% of the world's nuclear waste. And this is where the real problems begin. With this tiny 1%. First off, high level waste mainly consists of spent nuclear fuel. These are fuel rods that aren't efficient enough to be used in reactors anymore, but that doesn't mean they're no longer dangerous. In fact, spent fuel stays highly radioactive for up to hundreds of thousands of years. And because of this, extra care is taken when handling and storing it. Right now, the way we manage it is by placing the fuel rods in large, specially designed pools called spent fuel pools. These are usually located inside the nuclear plants themselves. The water acts as both a cost-effective radiation shield and a way to keep the fuel cool. After cooling down, the spent fuel can be transferred to what's called a dry cask storage. These are large containers made of steel and concrete that keep the fuel safe and isolated from the environment. While this entire process is effective at keeping the waste contained for maybe a few decades, it's still a temporary solution that requires constant monitoring and maintenance. Just like in active reactors, the water in spent fuel pools has to be constantly cooled and circulated, so it doesn't evaporate. Without the water, the radioactive fuel rods would eventually overheat and melt, releasing radioactive material. This is similar to what happened at Fukushima in 2011, when the earthquake and tsunami disabled the cooling systems inside the reactors. This led to a catastrophic meltdown in the reactor cores and hydrogen explosions. which released radioactive material into the environment. So, when transferring the waste into dry casks, they still need to be monitored regularly for signs of damage, leaks, cracks, and temperature fluctuations. And when you factor in that spent nuclear fuel stays radioactive for up to hundreds of thousands of years, it really puts into perspective how this is just a short-term fix. This is where the Forsmark spent fuel repository in Sweden comes in. It's designed to be one of the world's very first long-term and permanent repositories for spent nuclear fuel. The only other facility of this kind anywhere else in the world is Finland's Onkalo spent nuclear fuel repository, which is set to open sometime next year. It is being built using the same techniques and technology as the one in Forsmark. Once completed, the Forsmark spent fuel repository would be able to store high-level nuclear waste for as long as 100,000 years. To put that insane timescale into perspective, 100,000 years ago, the very first humans were just starting to make their way out of Africa. There weren't any pyramids, no civilizations, and no written history. Some evidence even suggests that humans had just begun to develop spoken language.
Simply put, 100,000 years is completely beyond our comprehension.
Yet, this structure is being built to last that entire period of time, and potentially even longer. The idea behind this groundbreaking project is actually quite simple. The nuclear waste will be buried deep underground, and it will be left down there completely untouched for as long as possible. Sounds simple enough, right? But don't be fooled. The underlying techniques and principles that make all of this possible are actually quite interesting and carefully planned. And it all begins with the careful selection of a location. The facility will be built more than 500 meters below solid bedrock, right here, on this exact spot directly beside the Forsmark nuclear power plant. This location was primarily chosen because of its geological stability and very little seismic activity. The underlying bedrock beneath this site is known to have little to no fracture zones. Studies have also shown that the rocks in the area were formed almost 2 billion years ago and have remained largely stable throughout that entire time. The perfect place to bury something and be almost certain that it will stay there for good. Another reason that this site was perfect is its proximity to both the Forsmark nuclear power plant itself as well as the SFR, Sweden's final repository for both low and intermediate level waste. This makes it so that the vast majority of the country's nuclear waste, no matter its level of radioactivity, can easily be transported in one central location. On the surface, the facility will be relatively unremarkable. There will be a stockpile for excavated dirt and stone, as well as a few buildings that will house staff and equipment. Obviously, the more interesting part is what lies below the surface. Starting from the facilities above ground, there will be a 5-kilometer winding ramp that will descend to a maximum depth of 500 meters underground. From this main downward path, a vast network of branching tunnels will be dug, totaling up to 66 kilometers in length, spread across an area of 3 to 4 square kilometers. These branching tunnels will then serve as the final and permanent resting place of Sweden's spent nuclear fuel. In total, these tunnels will have enough room for as much as 6,000 specially designed copper canisters, each containing around 2 tons of spent nuclear fuel. So the project will be capable of permanently storing all of Sweden's spent nuclear fuel that is currently in temporary storage, as well as any waste that will be produced within the next few decades. From hearing that, you could say that Sweden understood the issue, and they're working on a sophisticated solution. The project was first proposed back in 2009 by SKB, a company founded by the Swedish nuclear power industry for management and disposal of nuclear waste. After more than a decade of planning and research, it was finally approved in 2024. Construction on the repository began back in January 2025, with an estimated cost of a little over $1 billion. They're first going to finish building the structures above ground before any tunneling work begins. SKB estimates that the facility could start storing its very first spent fuel canisters by the late 2030s, once the first tunnels are completed. The rest of the tunnel network will continue to be dug out even after operations on site have already begun. The facility is projected to be completely filled by the year 2080. Yeah, that's the timescale we are looking at here. While completing all tunnels, a total of 2.3 million cubic meters of rock and soil will be excavated. Though the start of operations is still a little over a decade away, there are already some problems that could potentially delay that date even further. According to one study from Sweden's Royal Institute of Technology, the copper capsules that were designed to be resistant to corrosion could actually be more vulnerable to it than previously thought. A Swedish NGO has also filed a court appeal demanding for even more stringent safety assessments for the project. And if that goes through, the project could then be pushed back by at least a few more years. Despite this, construction has already begun, and they're hoping to stay on track of the current timeline.
So, how exactly is this entire process going to work?
Are they just going to bury the canisters underground and leave it like that? Well, obviously not. Both the Forsmark repository as well as the Onkalo in Finland are based on a technology known as KBS-3. This technique was developed by SKB as the very first permanent high-level radioactive waste disposal technology that will ever be implemented anywhere in the world. The idea behind it came from the fact that radioactive materials such as uranium or thorium have long existed naturally on the Earth's crust. And since they have remained beneath the surface and have not affected humans in all that time, the same conditions could probably be recreated for the permanent disposal of nuclear waste, buried deep underground in stable bedrock away from the environment. KBS-3 works like this. After nuclear fuel is used up in a power plant, it is first transported by ship to a facility known as Klab. This is the site where all spent nuclear fuel in Sweden is currently temporarily stored. It is located beside one of the country's three remaining operational nuclear power plants in Oskarshamn. The spent fuel remains here for 30 to 40 years, for radiation to gradually decay. Then they are secured in a specially made container. Okay, so this is the first of three protective barriers in the KBS-3 process. A copper canister that is 5 meters long and 1 meter in diameter. The outer copper casing will be 5 centimeters thick and is especially designed to be resistant to both corrosion and mechanical forces from the movements of rock underground. Inside the copper casing will be a cast iron insert, wherein the spent fuel can firmly be set in place. The entire thing is then welded completely shut using a special technique known as friction stir welding. After this, the weld joint is thoroughly inspected for cracks and other weaknesses, which could lead to a break in the seal. And once the spent fuel has been encapsulated, it is then transported to Forsmark. Upon its arrival, each capsule is placed into its own vertical deposition hole on the tunnel's floor. This entire process is done remotely using specially made vehicles to minimize the risk of humans getting exposed to radioactive materials. The second protective barrier in the process will be a buffer of water-absorbing bentonite clay. And here's a fun fact, it's actually the same substance that's used in cat litter, which makes it clump easily. The bentonite clay will make sure that no water makes its way to and from the canister. Once exposed to water, this buffer expands and makes the deposition hole even tighter, and thus more secure. Finally, the last and most obvious barrier of the three will be the bedrock itself. The spent fuel will be buried so deep beneath the surface, underneath geologically stable rock, that it is basically completely isolated from the environment. As canisters get deposited into the system, the tunnel itself will be completely sealed off again with concrete and bentonite clay. This process will be done for 6,000 canisters that the entire facility will be capable of holding. After that, the entire tunnel system will be completely filled up and sealed forever, as if there weren't even tunnels in the first place. All this nuclear waste that we buried deep underground will then be quite literally left down there permanently. The facilities on the surface will eventually be demolished, and the location will purposefully be left unmarked.
It's actually kind of interesting when you think about it. This facility will only ever truly be completed once it no longer exists.
It's hard to believe that for the entire 70 years that we had commercial nuclear power, we've never really had a final deposit. Well, until now, with the deposit from this video and the other one in Finland. It's a step in the right direction, as we definitely need more reliable deposits to store nuclear waste. This system that SKB has created is simple enough that it can be replicated in other places, under the required geological conditions.
But what do you think? Should we continue using nuclear power, or is the risk too high compared to its benefits? Let us know your thoughts in the comments down below. I'm excited to read them, and as always, thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.